Now that we know that we can view interest rates as essentially the price of renting money, I want to go through a bunch of scenarios just so we can understand how different things that happen in the economy might affect interest rates. So I'll just draw a bunch of supply and demand curves right over here. And once again, we're talking about the market for essentially renting money. So that right over here is the price of money, which we know is the interest rate on the vertical axis. And then in the horizontal axis, we have the quantity of money that is borrowed or lent in a given time period. So quantity, and this is in a given time period that is borrowed or lent. So borrowed, quantity borrowed, let's just say in a quantity borrowed in a year. And we know that there's some, if we just want to draw a demand curve, our starting demand curve, the first few dollars out in the economy, people are willing to pay a very high interest rate on them. And then every incremental dollar after that, people will get less marginal benefit. They might not find as good of a place to put that money. They're borrowing it for a reason. They're either going to borrow it to consume, to buy something that they always wanted that they think will make them happy, or more likely, they're borrowing it to invest it and hopefully getting a return higher than what they are borrowing at. And so you have a marginal benefit curve that would be downward sloping, something like that. Maybe it looks something like that. So that is our demand curve or our marginal benefit curve. And the supply curve, and once again, this is the exact same logic we use with the demand supply curve for any good or service, for money might look like this. Those first few dollars, someone has a very low opportunity cost of lending it out, so they're willing to lend it out at a very low interest rate. And then every incremental dollar after that, there's higher opportunity costs, and so people will lend it out at a higher and higher rate. And then you have a market equilibrium interest rate. And so let me copy and paste this, and then we could think about what happens in different scenarios. So copy and paste. So now we have two scenarios that we can work on, and then let me just do one more. Three scenarios. Now let's think of a couple. Let's say that the central bank of our country, and in the United States that would be the Federal Reserve, the central bank prints more money and then decides to lend out that money. And that actually is, in the previous video I talked about the central bank printing money and then dropping it from helicopters. That is not how money is actually distributed. It is distributed when central banks print money, the way that it enters into circulation in most countries is that the central bank then goes and essentially lends that money. The way it's done in the US Fed, for the most part, they go out and buy government securities, which is essentially lending money to the federal government. And they do that because that's considered to be the safest investment. But they go out there and they lend money. And so if this is our original supply curve, if this is our original supply curve, but now your central bank is printing more money and lending it out, what is going to happen over here? Well, your supply curve is going to shift to the right. At any given price, at any given interest rate, you're going to have a larger quantity of money being available. So it might look something like, your new supply curve might look something like that. And assuming that's the only change that happens, you see its effect. Your new equilibrium price of money, the rent on money, or the interest rate on money, is now lower. And that's why when the Federal Reserve says, I want to lower interest rates, they do so by printing money. And they print that money and they lend it out in the market. And that essentially has the effect of lowering interest rates. Now let's think about another situation. Let's say, so this is the Fed. Fed prints and lends money. And they're lending the money by buying government bonds. When you buy a government bond, you're essentially lending that money to the federal government. And I've done other videos on that where we go into a little bit more detail on that. Now let's think of another situation. Let's think about consumer savings go down. So one interesting thing about savings and investment are two opposite sides of the same coin. So when you save money, you literally put it into a bank, so that you have the whole financial system right over here. So this is the financial system. That money is then goes out and it is lent to other people. And then for the most part, hopefully, that money when it's lent is used to invest in some way. So this is lending. So if consumer savings goes down, that means that the supply of money will be shifted to the left. At any given price, or any given interest rate, there will be less money available. So in this situation, our supply curve is shifting to the left. And just that would increase interest rates. And then you could even make an argument that if consumer savings is going down, consumers are going to borrow less as well. And you could argue that maybe demand would go up as well. And so your demand could go up. And that would make the equilibrium interest rate even higher. Now let's do another scenario. Let's say that the federal government, in an effort to Let's say that they, for whatever reason, they're trying to finance a war or some type of public works project, and they don't want to raise taxes. So the government decides to borrow a lot more money. So the government is essentially going to go into a deeper, is going to expand its deficit. The government is going to borrow money. So here our supply isn't changing. I'm assuming that the central bank isn't changing its policies, how much it's printing, and savings rates aren't changing. But the demand is going to go up. The government is borrowing money. So if the government or is going to borrow more money than it was already doing. So at any given price, the demand for money is going to increase. We're going to shift to the right. And our new equilibrium interest rate, the rental price of money, is going to go up. So the whole point of this is just to show you that you really can think about money like any other good or service. If the supply of money goes up, then the price of money, which is interest rates, will go down. Let me write this down. So if the supply goes up, then the price, which is just interest rates, goes down. If the demand goes up, then the price. If the demand goes up, then the price of money will go up. So interest rates will go up. And then we could think about all of the other combinations where one demand goes down, then interest rates would go down, which is essentially just price. If supply went down, interest rates would go up. If something becomes more scarce, the price of it goes up. So the whole point of this is just to show that it's not that complicated. You'll see people say, government borrowing, it's crowding out other savings, interest rates go up, and it sounds like something deep is happening, but it really, they're just talking about the supply and demand for money. And you just have to remember that interest rates really are nothing more than the rental price for money.